All right, thanks, Mel. And exams around the corner for high school students, so we've got some great study hacks to help you ace that next test. From Ruth Rumack's Learning Center, or Learning Space, I should say,
yes.
Ruth Rumack is here. Good morning.
Hello, how are you?
Great, thank you.
We couldn't have you here at a better time because this is exam season. I can't even say better time. It's exam season, so what are some of those tips that we need to apply today to ace the exam?
Right away, we need to get organized. We need to help our students find a good space for studying, not studying on the bed.
Ooh.
Right? Talked about that.
So we
want to find a dedicated space that's quiet, free from distractions, and we want to help them get their coursework organized. So I recommend a new binder for each subject that they're going to have an exam. I also recommend putting in some dividers so you keep your classwork separate, your tests separate, and then your review pages separate so that you can access it quickly. And start gathering all that information. You may have missed classes. You may have been on a field trip. You may have just not been present in mind. And you want to make sure you have all the notes so that you're ready to go. It's not too early to start. Now is when we need to start preparing.
You have SMART in the front there, not SMRT.
No.
An acronym for?
Actual SMART. Yeah,
SMART. So SMART is set for SMART goals. And these are goals that you want to set for yourself. S is be specific. So what exactly do you want to study? M is measurable, meaning what will I achieve at the end of this time? A is achievable or attainable. So is it really, really realistic that I'm going to cover three chapters in the next 3 hours? S-M-A-R-T. Team. R is relevant. So are they relevant to the bigger picture? Do you actually, does this fit into your bigger plan? And then T would be time-based. So you need to know, I'm going to sit here for 3 hours or 2 hours or 20 minutes, and in that time, this is what I'm going to achieve.
So you have your desk, it's well-lit, a comfy chair.
Yes.
What do you have against the bed? Because I was one who's
well, there. You know what? The bed is a lovely place. It's very comfortable, but it's just too easy to fall asleep and to get distracted and just to get too comfortable. You want to be in a place where you can actually put your time in and concentrate and get something done.
And you mentioned that time. We were notorious. We spoke about this earlier for cramming.
Yeah.
Overnight, I pulled the all-nighters in university and did those exams that way. That's terrible, correct?
Well, you know, it's not helpful because it really increases anxiety and it doesn't allow the brain to actually absorb the information. So memory studies show us that we really need to have sort of short, repeatable steps in order to get to that place where we understand and we can retain. It's also a matter of that anxiety level. You know, when you've raised your cortisol levels through the roof because you've stayed up all night, it doesn't help you with remembering the next morning.
So you also say it helps to speak out loud and to write things down.
Yes.
So how come?
So at Ruth Rumack's Learning Space, we talk about read, write, talk, test. And this is a progression of memory. So first you start by reading it. I think one of the things that parents often see their children do is just reading the material. So how are you studying? Oh, I read it over. Well, you know, you're going to remember a little bit, but you're not going to remember everything. If you read it and then you write it down, and we know through MRI studies that the brain actually is activated in both sides, the right and the left brain is activated when you use cursive. It's activated more so when you write it down, but really the cursive is the best way. We talked about cursive another time. Mm-hmm. But writing things down allows the time to kind of process information as you are learning it. So then you read it, you write it, and then you talk about it. And the more you can talk about it, if you can tell your younger sister or your dog or your neighbor or your brother what you've learned, then you have a very good chance of being able to explain it on a test. And then testing yourself, too.
Mm-hmm. So have that support system around the home as well. What can parents do to help out?
I think parents need to be mindful that this is a very stressful time. So maybe reduce some of the household chores. Make sure that you're there for your kids. You know, provide healthy snacks. Go for a walk with your child. Say, you know what, you've been studying for an hour and a half, 2 hours, let's go for a little break. Let's take the dog for a walk. Number one, I think, listen to your children. Listen for signs of stress, extreme stress. You know, a lot of excessive crying, just shutting down, not being able to cope, and help them get through that. Because these are tough times. You know, exams count for a lot, and we want to make sure that we're there to support our kids.
And you recommend exercise, too. You say get the endorphins going before you study.
Yes, it's a really good idea to go for a quick walk or do a little yoga, a little mindfulness, something that just kind of centers your body, grounds you, and then it helps with memory and it also helps with stress as well.
So not something that exhausts you because then you'll be both physically and mentally fatigued.
Right.
Just something to ignite you a bit.
Yes, but you know what, when you take your break, don't take an hour break and just sit and watch television or be on your screen. Go and play a little round of basketball or go out and, you know, get some fresh air.
Awesome.
Something to keep you active.
Great advice.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ruru.
Bye.
Does anybody call you that?
Yes.
Ruth Rumack. So nice we'll say it twice. Ruru.
More info, breakfasttelevision.ca. We got more BT after this.
Our study guru.
Yes.
Oh, Ruru, the study guru.